Well, here we are. Got our Demerang. Wagner. It's apropos for the topic we're going to cover. Because we'll be looking at some footage from Nazi concentration camps. So, fair warning, it's disturbing. There's a reason why we're doing this. Because, contrary to what you may have been told in the history books, the Nazis didn't go anywhere other than the United States government. And they stayed in Ukraine. And that's what's happening. It's a continuation of the Nazis fighting the Soviets. But the concentration camps, they have, there's new concentration camps. They've made them all over the planet now because all the Nazis ever wanted was world domination. And they're poised to get it, folks. That's what the Great Reset is all about. It's a takeover. Agenda 21, Agenda 2030, depopulation, Henry Kissinger, Rockefeller, UN, NATO, the CIA, the fucking George Bushes, they're all fucking Nazis. So, we're gonna, We're gonna start out with a little bit of fun, though. We're gonna start out with a little bit of fun here. From Spike Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, Fuhrer's face, and is it red? Because this tune is sweeping the country, and everybody's out jeering at him. Okay.
When the Fuhrer says, here's the bad race, be hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, he's a great disgrace, so be hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face,
beautiful!
When her Goebbels says, we own the world in space, be hail! Right in her Goebbels' face, when her Goering says, they'll never bomb this place, be hail! Right in her Goering's face, are we not the Superman? Hey, pure Superman!
Yeah, we are the Superman!
Super duper Superman!
Is this not the land so good? Would you leave it if you could?
Yeah, this Nazi land is good. We would leave it if we could.
We bring the world to order. Heil Hitler's world to order.
Every one of foreign race will love the Fuhrer's face when we bring to the world disorder.
When the Fuhrer says, we are the master race. Be hail! Hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, he's a great disgrace, so be hail! Hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face, when the Fuhrer says, me is the master ace, be hail! Hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, he's a great disgrace, so be hail! Hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face!
Yeah, that's fun, right? We bring the world new order. Are you familiar with the new order? The new order for the world that Hitler wanted? The new world order of the Nazis? It's what they called the Pan-German state, but essentially it was what they wanted was the Reich to control Europe, and they believed that if the Reich was in control of Europe, then they could control the world. World domination. So that's actually pretty significant if you understand that the EU and the UN are run by the same interests. Rockefeller, Rothschild, the IMF, right? Who are Nazis? They're Nazis. I don't know if you know that. Rockefeller's a Nazi. Rockefeller's a Nazi. In fact, the Nazis, they were inspired by the eugenics programs of the Rockefeller Foundation and Carnegie, Dale Carnegie, and Kellogg, the dickhead with the fucking cornflakes. Battle Creek, Michigan, for a better race, a master race. Not to mention Margaret Sanger. Gotta love Margaret Sanger, right? I mean, Planned Parenthood. You knew what it was called before it was Planned Parenthood, right? Because she was really popular at the KKK rallies for the Negro Project. She wanted to, that's what she did. She's killing black babies. And she loved Hitler, and Hitler loved her. They gave each other awards, you know what I mean? That's what these dickbags do. Anyway, so I know I can go off on a tangent. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to play this video. It's from Nuclear Vault on YouTube. And just understand right now what's going on with the Ukraine. This is important. This is part of why we're here tonight looking at this stuff. You see, what we're looking at in Ukraine right now is the continuation of the Nazis fighting the Soviets. So in World War II, one of the first things that Hitler did was, stab Stalin in the back, which, you know, is like, whatever, all is fair in love and war, but Operation Barbarossa, he had this, like, trident attack on his road to Moscow. He never made it to Moscow, but as he traveled through Poland to Ukraine, he got to Western Ukraine, and they welcomed him with open arms. They were so happy. Nazis, thank you. You're going to save us from those wicked Soviets. And so the Western Ukrainians openly collaborated with Hitler and the Nazis. And the Eastern Ukrainians, you know, were Soviets. They didn't want the Nazis coming in and killing everybody. So that's what's happening today. There's two Ukraines. There's Eastern Ukraine that's Soviet, and there's Western Ukraine that is still Nazi. So I don't know how familiar you are with things like Operation Paperclip, but Operation Paperclip is declassified, and it basically tells the story about how at the end of the conflict in World War II, sure, a handful of judges and SS officers were hung at Nuremberg, but most of the high-ranking Nazi officials went to work for the United States government. They started the CIA, they started NASA, you know, a bunch of alphabet agencies. Even have a company called Alphabet. Maybe you heard of them. They have a thing called Google and YouTube. The parent corporation is called Alphabet. I don't know if you know that. It's one of those things that InQtel has invested in. So, familiar with InQtel, but it is the DARPA investment. Do you know who DARPA is? It doesn't. You know, you'll have to look some of this stuff up, folks. But InQtel is DARPA. Basically, DARPA is research and development for the Pentagon. This is all the deep state stuff. And so you have to understand that after World War II, the Nazis went to work for the United States government and became the deep state. And Rockefeller, Harvard, University, Johns Hopkins, Henry Kissinger, you know, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission, all that shit's all fucking Nazi run. And it ties into the Federal Reserve because of the Federal Reserve cartel, right? It's the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, and J.P. Morgan Chase. So, this is the way it goes with this stuff. It's a web. It is a fucking web. So you got to just hang in there. There's a reason why we're looking at this. You just understand that this, the Nazis, is all they've ever wanted is to take over humanity and treat us like a bunch of cattle and kill a lot of people. So, Georgia Guidestones, anyone? You know about Georgia Guidestones? Maintain humanity under 500 million. There's too many people using too much stuff. Thank you, Ted Turner. Thank you. Yeah. Fuck you, Ted Turner. Anyway, Bill Gates is a part of it, too. I don't really know how much you folks know about concentration camps, but it took a lot of organization for the Nazis to perform all their eugenics-based medical experiments. Well, kind of like these mutagenic mRNA serums. But the Nazis always did, you know, they had the best technology. Of course, they're backed by the IMF, so there wasn't an IMF then, but what's happening in Ukraine? Let me just wrap that up. Okay, so what's happening in Ukraine is a continuation of the Nazis versus the Soviets. The Nazis never went anywhere. After World War II, they went to work for the United States government. And so the spy networks that were spying on the Soviets, well, awfully handy for a Cold War. We're not going to tear that down. So they stayed in place. All the Nazis, they just kept on fighting the Soviets. But they were doing it for the United States government. And they stayed in Ukraine. And about 2014, I mean, look, there was a lot of stuff in between, sure. But 2014, right, George Soros, who reminisces about rounding people up for the Nazis to kill. Not people, Jewish people. Genetics, genocide, folks that were of a Jewish genetic expression. He reminisced about rounding those folks up. He was 14, 15 years old, I guess. I don't know. Can you believe he's still alive? Wait, the demon is living on the blood of babies or something. I don't know. They're fucking rotten. Have you seen this fucker? Have you seen George Soros? You know what I'm talking about? Jesus Christ, it's a horror show. It'd give you fucking nightmares just looking at the freak. But he's one of these billionaires, you know, hanging out with old Bill Gates. Bill Gates! Bill Gates! What does he have to do with anything? Oh, well, I guess, you know, his family is like a vassal family to the Rockefellers. I don't know how all of that works, but generations of Gates have worked for generations of Rockefellers. Frederick L. Gates and the Spanish flu, which was neither Spanish nor the flu, actually started with the vaccine. Oh, Gates was injecting vaccines and it started a pandemic. Imagine that. Yeah, it happened 100 years ago. But what happened in World War II with these concentration camps? Oh, yeah, there was a lot of organization going on. They needed like a counting machine. There were so many Jewish people that they were processing. Hey, who's got that technology? Oh, IBM. 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 So IBM, that's where IBM gets started. They got started helping the Nazis exterminate a race of people. IBM got its start in the Holocaust. And then Bill Gates comes along and steals DOS, right? And Microsoft is born. Is that curious? No? Nobody's curious about that. It doesn't matter. International patent 060606 might be kind of important to you, though. Microsoft and the biometric blockchain. It's another topic, I guess, for another day. We're going to go ahead and transition over to this here, and I'm going to let it play. I think I've got the volume kind of down on it. Yeah. And that's because there's not a whole lot of dialogue, but I've turned on the captions. And we're just going to watch it together. I'm going to probably just continue to offer my commentary here. I think I'm going to go ahead and put a camera on so you can see me on screen also.
I, George C. Stevens, Lieutenant Colonel, Army of the United States, hereby certify that from 1 March 1945 to 8 May 1945, I was on active duty with the United States Army Signal Corps, attached to Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Forces, and among my official duties was the direction of the photographing of Nazi concentration camps and prison camps as liberated by Allied forces. The motion pictures which will be shown following this affidavit were taken by official Allied photographic teams in the course of their military duties, each team being composed of military personnel under the direction of a commissioned officer. To the best of my knowledge and belief, these motion pictures constitute a true representation of the individuals and scenes photographed. They have not been altered in any respect since the exposures were made. The accompanying narration is a true statement of the facts and circumstances under which these pictures were made. George C. Stevens, Lieutenant Colonel, AUS, sworn to before me the second day of October, 1945, James B. Donovan, Commander, United States Naval Reserve.
I, E. R. Kellogg, Lieutenant, United States Navy, hereby certify that from 1929 to 1941, I was employed at 20th Century Fox Studios in Hollywood, California, as a director of photographic effects, and am familiar with all photographic techniques. Since the 6th of September, 1941, to the present date of the 27th of August, 1945, I have been on active duty with the United States Navy. I have carefully examined the motion picture film to be shown following this affidavit. And I certify that the images of these excerpts from the original negative have not been retouched, distorted, or otherwise altered in any respect, and are true copies of the originals held in the vaults of the United States Army Signal Corps. These excerpts comprise 6,000 feet of film selected from 80,000 feet, all of which I have reviewed, and all of which is similar in character to these excerpts. E.R. Kellogg, Lieutenant, United States Navy, sworn to before me this 27th day of August, 1945, John Ford, Captain, United States Navy. These are the locations of the largest concentration and prison camps maintained throughout Germany and occupied Europe under the Nazi regime. This film report, covering a representative group of such camps, illustrates the general conditions which prevailed.
More than 200 political prisoners were burned to death at this concentration camp near Leipzig. Others, among the original total of 350 inmates, were shot down by German elite guards as they dashed from the prison huts to celebrate the arrival of American troops outside the city. The atrocity story is told by the few who managed to survive. They relate how...
I just want to interrupt for a second. We're watching this for a reason. Because it's not history. It's the future. It's the future that they want for us. You can look in China right now and see this very thing happening. And China is the model of the New World Order. This isn't about history. This is about the future. If people don't start to wake the fuck up, this is what will happen. This is what they want for us. Hitler and the Holocaust and the genocide and all of this stuff at the concentration camps, it was a precursor to this time. If we allow it.
About 12 SS troopers and a Gestapo agent lured 220 starving prisoners into a big wooden building at this camp, sprayed the structure with an inflammable liquid, and then applied the torch. Machine guns set up at various vantage points mowed down many victims who ran from the burning building. Some miraculously escaped the hail of bullets, but were electrocuted by the live wires of a fence, which was the final hurdle for those fleeing the flames. The Leipzig victims were Russians, Czechs, Poles, and French. The dead are viewed by Russian women liberated from slave labor. At Peenig, Germany, a concentration camp was overrun by the 6th Armored Division, containing mainly Hungarians, who were people of wealth and esteem in their native country. Among them were young girls of only 16 years of age. The women show the scars of miserable existence under Nazi prison rule. American doctors examine the victims. Some have gangrenous wounds. Others suffer from fever, tuberculosis, typhus, and additional communicable diseases. All existed under appalling conditions in vermin-infested quarters and with little or nothing to eat. As soon as our troops arrived, arrangements were made to remove these people from the miserable surroundings.
Horrifying.
Under supervision of the American Red Cross, the stricken inmates are removed to a hospital which belonged to the German Air Force. Nazis who formerly maltreated them are forced to help look after the patients.
Well, at least they're good at following orders. How good are you at following orders? I think that's the test of whether or not you are.
The staff of German nurses is also forced to attend the victims.
You know, they believed what they were doing was right.
The women are able to smile for the first time in years.
I want you to try to imagine what it was like for these people. Imagine what it would be like for you or your family. What would you do?
At this concentration camp in the Gotha area, the Germans starved, clubbed, and burned to death more than 4,000 political prisoners over a period of 8 months. A few captives.
All right. Starved, clubbed, and burned. Starved, clubbed, and burned. You know what it's like to starve? You've been hungry without any food? You know what that's like? You know what it's like to starve? You know what it's like to starve. Well, you starve long enough, it makes you pretty weak, so I guess after you're starved for a while, then they beat you with a club, but you can't fight back. You're malnourished. You're weak. You've been, your body begins to consume itself when you're starved. Do you know what that's like? No, you've never been that hungry. And then after they had their fun and beat you down to you're nearly dead, then they light you on fire and watch you scream and writhe in pain until you're gone from this earth. By the thousands.
They've survived by hiding in the woods. The camp is chosen for a high command inspection led by General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Also present are Generals Omar N. Bradley and George S. Patton.
Eisenhower. I don't know really what he did in his presidency. I should probably learn more about it, but I do know on his way out he gave a famous speech with a fucking riddle where he told Americans to beware of the military-industrial complex. What do you think he meant by the military-industrial complex? What do you think he meant by that? I've thought a lot about that myself. The military-industrial complex. It's like, what did they call, what was that? Halliburton, right? Halliburton. It's what fascism is. It's when the corporations and the aggressive militant side of the government join up. That's what fascism is. Military-industrial complex. I believe that Eisenhower was warning us of the deep state infestation by the Nazi Party. I mean, we know now from Operation Paperclip, they didn't know that then. I mean, it hadn't been declassified. Eisenhower knew it. Knew that the Nazis went to work for the United States government, started the deep state intelligence agencies, espionage agencies. And it wasn't long after Eisenhower that we had the last American president, which was John F. Kennedy, who was trying to, I guess, among other things, dismantle the Federal Reserve. Uh-oh. You know, the last people that opposed the Federal Reserve all died in a big accident on a boat we call the Titanic. But, so the last American president, John F. Kennedy, assassinated, right? And ever since 11/22/63, every single president in the White House has been a Nazi operative, which is why we had such a war with the Soviets. And that's what's happening in Ukraine. So when we're supporting Ukraine, just know that that's code for Nazis. Your blue and yellow flag. Your blue and yellow flag is code for Nazi. That's what that is. Well, either you're with us or you're with the terrorists, according to George Bush Jr. The Bushes are probably the biggest American Nazi family that there is, which is why he was the one that attacked, gave us another Pearl Harbor, didn't he? Attacking Manhattan. All right.
4th Armored Division of General Patton's 3rd Army liberated this camp early in April. The generals viewed... They see the woodshed where lime-covered bodies are stacked in layers and the stench is overpowering.
Bodies are stacked in layers and the stench is overpowering. This isn't the history. This isn't history. Okay, yes, this happened in the past, but we're watching this because this is the future that they have planned for us. This is the future they want. The Nazis are trying to take over. All they've ever wanted was world domination. And the bodies will be stacking up just like this. And you see, they're emaciated. They've been starved. Have you ever been that hungry? Have you ever been that hungry? Do you know what that's like?
Former inmates demonstrate how they were tortured by the Nazis. American congressmen invited to view the atrocities were told by General Eisenhower, "Nothing is covered up. We have nothing to conceal. The barbarous treatment these people received in the German concentration camps is almost unbelievable. I want you to see for yourselves and be the spokesman for the United States."
You understand? There ain't no human rights, people. There ain't no fucking human rights. Nobody's gonna protect you from this shit. The UN is run by these same fucking dickholes, the Nazis. You ever wonder why it was in fucking Switzerland?
The general and his party next see the crude woodland crematory, actually a grill made of railway tracks. Here, the bodies of victims were cremated. Charred remains of several inmates still lay heaped atop the grill. Another group to visit the Ohrdruf camp is composed of local townspeople, including prominent Nazi party members. They'll be taken on a forced tour of the campsite by Colonel Hayden Sears, commander of the 4th Armored Division's Combat Command A, which captured Ohrdruf. A German medical major is compelled to accompany the townspeople.
Did he look worried about that? You see that look on his face, that son of a bitch. The reason I think that's important, there he is. The reason I think that's important is because that's the face of someone who knows that they've been caught. Knows that they've been caught. Knows what they have been doing is wrong. And now is afraid. Because they have to pay the fucking piper. But until they're caught, they don't fucking stop. He would have kept on going as long as they would have allowed him. You understand? He's just following orders. Starving human beings, treating them the way that he did. And now he's got to go and face the townspeople that he's been torturing. Medical officer. Medical officer. Oh, this is for your health, is it? Yeah, the medical health authorities. So yeah, you gotta listen to them, right? Look at the face on that fucking dickbag. He knows he's been caught. He knows what he was doing is wrong. And now he's gonna have to fucking pay for it. This is our future if we allow it. Just like he was allowed to do whatever fucking evil shit he was up to until he was stopped.
Colonel Sears stands by as the Nazis are informed that they must see all the horrors at the camp. First, the visitors view some 30 freshly killed bodies lying in the courtyard of the camp where they'd been shot on the evening preceding the entry of American tanks. These two are identified as slave labor bosses who maltreated, tortured, and killed their workers. Next, to the woodshed, which the Nazis are reluctant to enter, but Colonel Sears demands that they get a close-up look at the most gruesome of sights.
Why do you think they were reluctant to enter the woodshed? Why do you think they were reluctant to enter the woodshed? Any thoughts? Is it because it was stacked with the bodies and the stench was overpowering? Was it the stench of death that was the reason they didn't want to enter there? Or was it the fact that they're being confronted with the fucking evilness of their crimes. They would have gone, they go in that woodshed every fucking day, throw the bodies in there. They don't fucking have a problem going in the woodshed and having to deal with the smell of the fucking bodies. They didn't want to go in there with somebody that was going to make them answer for it. As long as they could do it in the fucking dark, they were fine. You have to understand what's going on here, people. It's the future that they want for us.
The labor bosses enter.
That dickbag. These fucking Nazis, they didn't go anywhere. They went to the UN. They started the UN. World Health Organization, UNICEF.
According to reports, the local Nazis continued their tour of the camp without apparent emotion. All denied knowledge of what had taken place at Ort Druf.
All right. They went through and they looked at all this horror without any emotion. And they denied knowledge. They denied. So I don't know if you... Something that I do is I work a lot with narcissistic behavior patterns in people. One of the things that is a defining characteristic of a narcissistic personality type disorder is the lack of empathy. Lack of empathy. It's the lack of empathy. Oh, they have feelings. They feel really fucking sad for themselves if they get caught. But they don't have any empathy. They can't put themselves in your shoes. They can't imagine what it's like to be the prisoner. They have no apparent emotion about it. And then when confronted with, look what you've done. Oh, no, sir. No, I don't know anything about this. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. Prove it. That's what a narcissist does. That's what a... And these are narcissistic systems. Fascism is a narcissistic government system.
They are taken to the crematory 2 miles outside the camp, where the list of the atrocities is read for all to hear. 4,000 Ort Druf victims are said to include Poles, Czechs, Russians, Belgians, Frenchmen, German Jews, and German political prisoners.
If you think this was about the Jewish people, did you just get a load of that list? Is anybody in Europe, anybody who's not the master race, anybody who isn't, it's everybody. The scapegoat aspect of the Jewish people, though, that's another narcissist thing, but don't ever fool yourselves that this was only for them and not for the. There's one master race and you ain't it.
The day before these Nazis visited the camp, the Burgermeister of Ort Druf was forced to view the horrors. He and his wife were later found dead in their home, apparently suicides.
Bitches. Couldn't face the fucking music, huh?
American officers arrive at a Nazi institution seized by First Army troops. Under the guise of an insane asylum, this has been the headquarters for the systematic murder of 35,000 Poles, Russians, and Germans sent here mainly for political and religious consideration.
35 fucking thousand political prisoners, anti-vaxxers, Trump supporters, racist, insurrectionists, domestic terrorists. You just throw them in there, just like they do in China. You know, the Uyghurs and all that stuff. Just throw them in there, kill them, whatever you gotta do. You know. Could use them for some experimentation first. It doesn't matter. They're not humans. They don't get human rights. They're ours now. They're our prisoners. We get to do what we want. Political and religious. Oh, geez. Religious, huh? So they weren't Satanists, so I guess they had to die, huh? They weren't the master race. There's only one master race, folks, right? And you ain't it. Because if you were, you'd know it. Because the master race, they go around wearing crowns on their head. They've got billions of dollars in the fucking bank. In fact, they don't even use banks because they are the bank. There's only a handful of those dickbags. And they want to kill the rest of us. Take over the fucking planet. That's all they've ever wanted.
Those still alive are examined by Major Hermann Volker of the American War Crimes Investigation Team. The townspeople in Hadamar, Germany, called this place the House of Shudders.
Hospital for the mentally ill. They set it up as a base to kill 35,000 fucking political and religious prisoners. But they starved them first. Look at that. It's a skeleton with skin on him. His body's been fucking eating itself for who knows how long. Your body begins to consume itself when there's no nourishment. Look at this. Have you ever been that fucking hungry? I've been hungry.
Meanwhile, at the graveyard attached to the institution, bodies are exhumed for autopsy. 20,000 are buried here. 15,000 who died in a lethal gas chamber were cremated and their ashes interred.
So, just real quick here, the whole thing about the gas chambers, because that's kind of a big deal with these concentration camps. They, after they starve you or, like, you know, work you to death or whatever the fuck it is that they want to do, or near death, they've totally, like, raped you of everything and basically turned you into a walking fucking skeleton. Then they go and they give you that shower in the gas chamber, right? Get everybody in there and turn on the gases. Do you know who gave Hitler that idea? Do you know where the gas chamber started? Do you know who the first motherfucker was to use gas chambers to kill people? Undesirables. Mentally ill. Dark-skinned people. People with disabilities. Orphans. Oh, and don't forget the deviants. You know. Deviants. Dale Carnegie. What does it take to play Carnegie Hall? Well, you can't be dark-skinned or gay. Gas chambers. Dale Carnegie. That's where Hitler got it. You understand? The American eugenicists. The American eugenics program. This is what eugenics looks like. Mass graves. Fauci did it in New York City.
Death books found hidden in the wine cellar of the Hadamar Institution revealed part of the story of the mass killings. The bulky volumes contained thousands of death certificates. Profession unknown, nationality unknown, was written after each name.
At least they got their names down, huh? Guess they had that in their IBM computers. Where IBM came from.
The corpses are lined Jesus. Up pending the arrival of WCIT officers.
Do you see what the fuck is going on here? This is just a little peek behind the curtain of what these demons really fucking get off on. When you hear Klaus Schwab, some people jokingly call him Satan Klaus. Like Santa Claus, right? Like Satan Klaus. Jeff Berwick says that a lot. When you hear this fucking dickbag talk about Build Back Better. This is what he's talking about. This is an unprecedented opportunity for a great reset. Well, you don't like the way things are now, huh, Klaus? You just want to be like your old daddy and do some more fucking Nazi shit? Just kill people? Oh, yeah. You ever hear this guy talk? He sounds like a Nazi. His dad was a Nazi. I guess that doesn't mean you're a Nazi, does it, Klaus? No. But your fucking books make you a Nazi, so... We all know, but pay insufficient attention to the frightening scenario of a major cyber attack. Oh, it was Russian hackers. Really close, it was Russian hackers. You'll never know. You'll never know.
Major Bolker performs the autopsy. A detailed listing is made of all clinical data.
Just business as usual, folks.
Interrogating the institution heads. Dr. Vollmann, the taller man, was the top Nazi in charge of the place. The other man entering the room is Carl Willig, chief male nurse. He admits to killing inmates with overdoses of morphine. The testimony of other witnesses substantiated the fact that morphine was issued at the institution without attempt at...
Okay. Midazolam. Have you heard that word before? Have you heard that word? I didn't know that word before 2020, I can tell you that much. But apparently government health officials were stocking up on midazolam, which is used in lethal injections. And it's sort of like a morphine. It has like a morphine effect, midazolam. And it was part of the COVID protocol in the first wave of 2020. Midazolam was particularly used in the UK, in Britain, to murder the old folks there. We pretty much murdered the old folks here with Run Death Is Near, or Remdesivir, which was, lining the pockets of Anthony Fauci. Oh, Ouchie-Fauci. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to keep interrupting. It's just you have to understand that this isn't about history. We're watching this because this is how they fucking operate, and it's what they have in store for us. If we don't wake the fuck up and stop the madness.
Making a record. As many as 17 at a time died from the morphine injections. Investigating officers were told that the Nazis never bothered to determine whether a victim may have survived the overdosage. Instead, all were hustled off to the graveyard and buried in piles of 20 to 24.
Yeah, I'm going to keep pausing it, but... They just gave him the morphine, right? And if you were lucky, you died from it. Otherwise, you were just subdued enough that it didn't fucking matter and they could hustle you off to the graveyard in piles of 20 to 24 and then bury you alive. The real fucking horror show, folks.
The prisoners are removed to await trial. A Hadamar judge told the investigators that when the 10,000th victim died, the institution heads and Nazi officials staged a celebration.
We're only about 20 minutes in on like a 59 and a half minute video here. I feel like I'm gonna throw up. I'm serious. When the 10,000th victim had died, 10,000th, they were keeping good count of it because they had those IBM counting machines. The Nazis were using IBM computing to keep track of all the people that they murdered. IBM? Huh. Microsoft? Anybody? I love my personal computer. What does Microsoft have to do with it, Rockstone? Come on. Well, Microsoft was Bill Gates, right? Bill Gates. Yeah, it's Bill Gates. Okay. Well, Bill Gates' family has been vassals of the Rockefellers for generations. So, Rockefeller Foundation, you know, Johns Hopkins, Harvard, sure. You know, Trilateral Commission, Council on Foreign Relations. Heck, the Rockefellers gave a big chunk of Manhattan over to UN so they could build that beautiful fucking ugly building of theirs. It looks like a slab of stone, almost like a Georgia Guidestone. Rockefeller, yeah, what's wrong with that? They're good guys. Yeah. They're great guys, Rockefeller. They inspired Hitler to do all of this fucking crap and then gave him the money to pull it off. Rockefeller, dude? You can't just say shit like that. Well, look it up. It's on fucking Wikipedia. They haven't scrubbed it yet. And the 10,000th fucking prisoner was murdered. They had a celebration. They wanted to kill 10,000 more, starve them to death. They were that fucking sick shit that they were doing. Bury them alive, whatever the fuck.
Keeping track of their IBM computers. It offers evidence of Nazi brutality imposed on Belgian patriots during the period of German occupation.
Sorry. Nazi brutality imposed on Belgian patriots during the period of German occupation. They weren't Germans they were occupying. They were Nazis they were occupying. Now, maybe back then you had to be German to be a Nazi, I don't know. But that changed after World War II when they all went to work for the United States government, so... could be an American occupation.
Many of the Department of Homeland Security remain untouched, such as the blood-stained coffins, demonstrating how the victims were tied up for administering vicious beatings. A barbed wire stick was used on the backs of the men.
So, you understand this is a system that they have in place. They institutionalized this barbarism. You saw that? They had it all there. This is how we tie him up. This is how we beat. We use the barbed wire stick. That's what it's government order issue. That's the it's the protocol. That's what we're supposed to do. Yep. Uh huh. Yep. And we get 10,000 of them. We have a party. Uh huh. Oh Jesus, fucking Jesus. I grew up on a farm. I knew a lot about barbed wire. I'm always real careful with it. I don't fucking rub it on my back like that.
Holy crap. Another method for rendering a patriot helpless while he was attacked by his Gestapo guards.
Real brave, huh? We're talking about cowardly piece of shit fucking bullies. What we're talking about here. Sons of bitches. Look at that. That's what they would do.
The Nazis also would tie a man in chains in this manner and then apply the tourniquet.
Just another day at the office, honey. Jesus.
A Berlin-made thumb screw and how it was used.
There's that fine German craftsmanship, huh? You like that Volkswagen? You like that Mercedes-Benz? Yeah, some good German engineering there. You go, thumb screw, Berlin-made thumb screw. This is how you do it, folks. Yep, you just sort of put the thumb in there and screw it the fuck down.
A victim shows scars caused by repeated beatings. Others show what happened to them as results of both beatings and cigarette burns.
The cigarette burning was just the fun. We were just having fun, folks. Come on, lighten up a little bit, God. Oh yeah, maybe I had to put this fucking cigarette out in your eyeball, dickbag. There's no excuse for that. Jesus.
A Belgian demonstrates the manner in which his crutch was split by the Nazis.
Holy fuck. This is sick shit. Like, I wasn't really totally prepared for it. I gave a warning before we started that this is going to be some graphic, disturbing stuff. I haven't watched this video. I'm watching it with you. Dahmer was bad, right? It was some weird shit he did to people there. But what he did was nothing compared to this. They fucking... Do you understand? It's an institution. It's a system that they had, that they did this as a system. The government system. It was the government that fucking did this. They ripped the man apart. They ripped his fucking crotch apart. Why? Why?
A woman discloses the results of a beating.
Jesus.
The Harlan concentration camp near Hanover. Out of 10,000 Polish men brought here 10 months prior to April 1945, only 200 remain.
Oh, they were only 200 away from getting their 10,000. They almost had a fucking party.
Prisoners who could walk were removed before American troops entered Hanover. The others were left to starve and die. Immediate relief was provided for them with the arrival of a Red Cross club mobile. The men broke into tears when they were given hot soup, other food, and cigarettes and clothing.
This is the future. This is your children. This is what they want for your children.
When questioned, Most of these men could not remember when they'd last eaten a decent meal. Many had been beaten and tortured so long their minds had failed.
This is happening right now in China. You wouldn't know it though, Xi Jinping, he looks so fucking cool, right? Sitting up there, his hair's always fucking perfect. He always seems very composed. Seems like such a nice man.
Some of the inmates are too weak to leave their bunks or even eat. Others bunk together to keep their frail bodies warm.
This is gonna freaking haunt me.
The deaths continue even after liberation of the camp. Some were too far gone when the Americans took over.
Those are good Americans. What happened to good Americans? Where are all the good Americans now? Certainly not in our government. We've been taken over by the fucking Nazis.
An AMG sergeant checks the list of inmates.
11-22-63.
The victims relate the atrocity story and photographs are made for further documentation of the horrors committed at the Hanover camp. This concentration camp was overrun by American troops in April. The prisoners were mainly Poles and Russians. Maltreated and starved, savage watchdogs were used to help guard the camp. German civilians are forced to dig up the bodies. This is the second burial ground for the victims. The spot where they were originally buried after the massacre was apparently too close to the town. The Arnstadt villagers could not tolerate the stench of the dead. And they themselves moved the bodies to this site. Now they again must exhume the corpses, this time under armed persuasion.
Did you catch that business about the dogs? Have you seen those robot dogs? They're pretty cool, right? I don't really watch a lot of, like, TV shows, because I don't have time. I don't have the interest anymore. And I'm so disillusioned about everything fucking Disney shit. But, I love Star Wars, so even though it's a Disney operation now, I was watching the Book of Boba Fett, and I do like Jon Favreau. He's got a good knack for what he's doing there. But he was probably, episode one or two of the fucking Book of Boba Fett. And you got these fucking robot dogs in there walking around the street like it's some kind of novelty or some shit. And the Disney robotics is like, you look that up, dude. Look up the Disney robotics because it's a fucking thing. These robot dogs. So I'm just bringing it up because they're talking about how the, the classic German Shepherd was helping. You wonder how, a few German soldiers could, usher hundreds of people to their death without having, the hundreds of people turn on them. And part of it is the viciousness of their fucking dogs. Robot dogs with guns on their back. Robot dogs. You think a German Shepherd was vicious? Just imagine what that robot dog would be like. It's just gonna fucking shoot you. Unless you have an EMP device, you got a pocket EMP on you? You know how to make one? You know what that is? All right, you'll be good. You can do that. You can do that, you'll be all right. EMP will fry the fuckers.
Victims bear the marks of violent deaths.
Violent deaths. Violent deaths. Violent deaths. You're all fucking starved, too. Not like a fat fucking corpse in there.
American troops view the evidence of Nazi barbarism.
Nazi barbarism. The origin of the word barbaric or barber. Oh, the barber. Yeah, that's right. The barb. In fact, the le mot en français for beard is barbe. The barber, the barbarian. They were hairy motherfuckers. The Germans were not necessarily hairy, but they were barbaric. The Nazis were barbaric.
Camp at Nordhausen, liberated by the 3rd Armored Division, 1st Army. At least 3,000 political prisoners died here at the brutal hands of SS troops and pardoned German criminals who were the camp guards. Nordhausen had been a depository for slaves found unfit for work in the underground V-bomb plants and in other German camps and factories.
Gonna fucking haunt me.
Amid the corpses are human skeletons too weak to move. Men of our medical battalions work 2 days and nights binding wounds and giving medications. But for advanced cases of starvation and tuberculosis, there are often no cures. The survivors are shown being evacuated for treatment in Allied hospitals. Victims are mainly Poles and Russians, with considerable numbers of French and other nationalities also included in the camp roster.
Why did this happen? What did the Nazis want? What were the Nazis after? Isn't about the Jewish people.
The Burgermeister of Nordhausen is ordered to provide 600 German male civilians who will inter the 2,500 unburied bodies at the camp.
Hitler himself was a Rothschild. His father was a Rothschild.
A priest administers last rites for the dead while the corpses are being carried to the hillside for burial.
Yes, good job, priest. Hitler's father got the name Hitler from his mother's husband, his stepfather. He was like 8 or 9 when she got married to Hitler. But she had
then the actual burial
the
in
baby,
common grave of 2,500 Nordhausen victims.
Hitler, Aloysius Rothschild, was Hitler's father. The name Hitler came from Aloysius Rothschild's stepfather because he was an illegitimate. His mother was a servant in the house of Rothschild. Vienna. What's the significance of that? Well, Hitler made a big stink about the Jews, right? The master race and all this. He wasn't tall or blonde hair or blue-eyed or anything, was he? It was weird. I guess the master race is. Or something. I don't know.
Senior grade Jack H. Taylor, U.S. Navy, Hollywood, California. Believe it or not, this is the first time I've ever been in the movies. I've been working overseas in occupied countries in the Balkans for 18 months. In October 44, I was the first Allied officer to drop into Austria. I was captured December 1st by the Gestapo, severely beaten, even though I was in uniform, severely beaten and considered as a non-prisoner of war. I was taken to Vienna prison, where I was held for 4 months. When the Russians neared Vienna, I was taken to this Mauthausen concentration lager, an extermination camp, the worst in Germany, where we have been starving and beaten and killed. Fortunately, my turn hadn't come. Two American officers, at least, have been executed here. Here is the insignia of one, a U.S. Naval officer. And here is his dog tag. And here is the Army officer, executed by gas in this locker. There were five or six ways, by gas, by shooting, by beating, that is, beating with clubs, by exposure, that is, standing out in the snow naked for 48 hours and having cold water thrown on them in the middle of winter, starvation, dogs, and pushing over a 100-foot cliff. This is all true, has been seen, and is now being recorded.
So here's the thing. You just named a whole bunch of ways that they were killing people at the extermination camp. And just notice the nuance of a difference here, because he was in a prison camp. He was in a prison camp, and then in Vienna, and then I guess the Soviets marching towards Vienna there, it scared the Nazis, and they moved him on, and they said, well, you know what, let's take this guy to the extermination camp, the worst in Germany, right? Like, so he spent, I don't know however long he said, at the worst extermination camp in Germany. And they said, well, what were the ways that they used to exterminate people there, here? And he said, oh, there's like five or six ways, you know? I mean, they'd beat you, starve you. He said dogs. I guess the dogs would tear you apart. They'd leave you out in the snow for 48 hours in the dead of winter and then throw ice water on you or whatever. So you fucking die. Just imagine, that's a fun one. That's a good way to go, right? That's a good death right there. And then, you know, if all else fails, they just push you over the 100-foot cliff. What I want you to notice is, unlike the gas chamber, unlike shooting him in the fucking head or some shit, this didn't require any extra resources. They weren't even hanging people like that right there. I mean, you know, they used the rope to tie you up and beat you to death. They didn't use the rope to hang you like civilized people. They didn't have to pay for bullets. They didn't have to pay for the whatever gas it was that they were using. So it was very efficient. There's that German efficiency. They beat you. They starve you. They leave you in the snow. They have the dogs tear you apart, or they just push you off a 100-foot cliff. Doesn't cost a thing. Oh. Well, that's very pleasing. The Fuhrer is going to love that. The Fuhrer loves that. Keep up the good work. You remember now, if you get up to 10,000, we all have a party.
This uniform, I came here in uniform, but it was taken away from me, and this was substituted with my number in USA. I have been condemned to death as another American also in this camp, but fortunately the 11th Armored Division has come through and saved us some time.
Well, we're going to need another 11th Armored Division to fucking save us. Where are they coming from? Don't look to NATO. Don't look to the UN. Don't look to the United States, because the United States is going to be the one doing it to you. Because it's not the same fucking government since 11-22-63. It's not the government that liberated these camps. That's what Eisenhower was trying to tell us. And then they took out Kennedy 11-22-63, and they took over ever since then. Ever since then. That's why it looks like the two parties are just two wings of the same bird. Because they are. The same fucking Nazi bird. I tell you what, the CIA really doesn't... Jesus, fuck, this is gonna give me... This is gonna haunt me for the rest of my fucking life. The CIA doesn't like it when you question their story. They said, oh, there was this... There was a second gunman. There was a grassy knoll. There was a... I don't know. Sure, it wasn't Kennedy's... detail. It wasn't anybody that worked for the United States government inside CIA fucking operative that did it. The CIA didn't murder Kennedy. It was Oswald. Yeah, it was commie. Oh, the Soviets did it? Yep. Well, it couldn't be the Nazis. I mean, they all worked for the U.S. government, right? It was Soviet. Oh, yeah. Wait a minute, but it's not making sense. Oh, are you a conspiracy theorist? You don't question our narrative. You don't question our fucking story. Oh, now you're going to look into it? You think you're going to do some fucking research on that? You can do your own research now? No, that's not how this works. You just believe what we tell you. That's how the CIA operates. That's what they did with the Kennedy assassination, right? A lot of people was like, hey, that official story just doesn't make any sense. Yeah, conspiracy theorists. You can't listen to those people, they're crazy. They're just crazy. We're the United States government. You listen to what we say. 11-22-63 is when the Nazis took over the United States government. Which is why the Cold War was a Nazi proxy war with the Soviets. What's happening with Ukraine now is a continuation of the Nazis warring with the Soviets. That's all this fucking is. So you want to walk around, wave your blue and yellow flag, and do all your virtue signaling, just understand there's two Ukraines. There's a Soviet Ukraine in the east, and there's a Nazi Ukraine in the West. I can't read Russian, bro. I'd have to, You know what? I'm glad that you're here. God bless you. I'll have to look it up. I got Google Translate. I guess I still use the alphabet and stuff. I'm gonna have a copy. You have to give me a minute here, sir. Jesus Christ, this is gonna haunt me forever. I'm looking it up. Okay, gotcha. All right. Yeah, I think you might have even been 100% correct.
Pictorial evidence of the almost unprecedented crimes perpetrated by the Nazis.
Let me see if I can reverse my translation here.
The story in written form is contained in the official report of the Prisoner of War and Displaced Persons Division of the United States Control Council, which has been forwarded from Supreme Allied Headquarters to the War Department in Washington. It states that 1,000 boys under 14 years of age are included among the 20,000 still alive. But the survivors are males only, and the death rate is about 200.
So was that, and you're gonna have to excuse me because I don't know if that was Ukrainian or Russian. Actually, is that Ukrainian or Russian? Hold on.
Nationalities and prison numbers are tattooed on the stomach.
It's Ukrainian. Okay, gotcha. All right.
Nationality. It says the camp was founded when the Nazi Party first came into power in 1933 and has been in continuous operation ever since, although its largest populations date from the beginning of the present war. One estimate put the camp's normal complement at 80,000.
It's sick. Now, you're, Roman Ruthless.
In the official report, the Buchenwald camp is termed when, extermination.
I don't have a lot of really close friends, but I have one friend, who's very dear to my heart, and she is from Kiev. Kiev, they're calling it.
By these means, the report continues, many tens of thousands
Saint
of
Olga of Kiev.
Personnel of Europe have been exterminated. Bodies stacked one upon
yeah,
another
her.
Found outside the crematory. The Nazis
but I never knew about the two
experiments and vivisections with prisoners
different. Let me just pause this, because if you're with me, Roman, I'd like your opinion about this.
The experimental set.
I just kind of want to know where you sit. I didn't know. I didn't really understand about Ukraine, that there's two Ukraines, until recently. I understand that, essentially the Eastern Ukraine is Soviet, Western Ukraine is Western Ukraine, but there's the right sector, right? What they call the right sector. In the right sector, who apparently Sarkozy is cool with, right? The right sector, because he was talking about, bringing the Azovs into the Ukrainian military and stuff. So I guess my question to you is, are you Ukraine Soviet? Are you Ukraine Nazi? Or are you Ukraine human? You know? Where are you at with that? Yeah, I don't know. It's horrifying when I look at these videos. This is going to haunt me forever. Because this isn't just history, right? I mean, this is happening today. It's happening today in China, and it's happening wherever. Wherever evil lies in the hearts of men. There's videos, obviously, right, that we've seen coming out. Both mostly it's coming from the Ukrainian side. I haven't seen a lot of videos coming from the Russian troops, so just seeing videos from the Ukrainian troops, but it looks like some war crimes happening, right? Like Nazi stuff. So I'm trying to say to you, I don't know if you're still even watching or how much you catch what I'm saying, but I have a heart for Ukraine. I live in a town. The town I live in has a sister city in Ukraine. You probably know it as Sevastopol. Was it Sevastopol? In California, we call it Sebastopol because that's the town I live in Sonoma County, Sebastopol. Sevastopol? Sevastopol? We call it Sevastopol or something? It's like in the ocean, right? Like, I've seen it on the map. In Ukraine. I'm saying I have a heart for Ukrainian people. Someone very close to me who I care about quite a bit is from Kiev. She's Ukrainian. But I'm concerned. I'm concerned about the fucking Nazis. I'm concerned about the ones waving the fucking swastika flag. These fucking demonic dickholes is what I'm worried about. So, thank you for responding. Thank you. Let me, this guy makes me crazy. I need to translate what you wrote here. I'm really glad you're here. You know, and this is what I always say to everybody is, I'm glad that you're here, and I'm glad that you share your thoughts and your opinions, and it's not important for me that we agree. You know, I don't need everybody to agree with what I'm saying. Okay. So this could be, I don't know if this is the right translation. Oh, must be listened to because it likes to behave. Okay. As if we didn't want it. So this is what it's telling me in the translator. It says that history must be listened to. So I'm glad that you appreciate that we're watching this, and thank you again for joining. It says, because it likes to behave if we didn't want it. But I think what you're saying is we have to look at these horror shows, right? Like, we have to look at this. Or we'll have to experience it if we're not aware of it. So that's kind of, and that's exactly what we're doing here. I mean, what I'm saying is that we don't, again, and I'm using the translator, so I don't know if what I'm saying is exactly correct, but I just want to say thank you for being here. What is your perspective on what's happening here, you know? What, so I guess it mostly in the West, right? Like in America and Britain and Europe and stuff, there's a lot of support for Ukraine. And that's really great, except for the swastikas, right? So what I want to make it clear that I have a heart for the people of Ukraine. One of the people that I care about the most in the world, she's from Kiev. And I live in a town called Sevastopol, which is a sister city of the Ukraine. There's a lot of connection that I feel. And I also understand that geographically, Ukraine is sort of in the middle of the Soviets and everybody else. And so I want you to feel safe and comfortable to share your thoughts, your opinions. I'm just trying to understand, do you sympathize, like, politically with the right sector? You know, are you cool with the swastika? And if you are, that's okay. I'm just curious, you know, how you feel about it. Amen. Amen. We will never forget, right? That is very important. That is very important. And that's why, because this shit is real. And it's not just in a history book. And for you in Ukraine, this is part of the reason why we're talking about this tonight here. Is because all of a sudden we have Nazis and Soviets again. You know? And so here we go. So let's take a look at the last time when the Nazis were having a party, every time they killed 10,000, you know, people. And they did it with German efficiency. They didn't use bullets. They didn't even use food, right? They starved people. Beat them with sticks, tied them up and beat them, left them out in the snow, pushed them over a cliff. All sorts of very inventive ways to kill thousands of people without ever having to fire a bullet. And the Fuhrer likes that. That's very good. That's very good for the bottom line.
New toxins and antitoxins were tried out on prisoners.
And there's nothing new under the sun.
Who entered the experimental buildings ever emerged alive. One of the weapons used by SS guards. The body disposal plant. Inside are the ovens which gave the crematorium a maximum disposal capacity of about 400 bodies per 10-hour day. Gold-filled teeth were extracted from bodies before incineration. Yep.
So 400 per 10-hour day, that is 40 corpses incinerated every hour, 40 per hour. China has some pretty efficient crematoriums. You know that? In fact, there's some story about how after the, you know, the, like the first kind of COVID outbreak in China, you know, not right, like right now, they got Shanghai locked down and more tests and more cases. It's amazing. Every time you test, you get a bunch of cases. It's that test you're using. Anyway. But they were burning there's you could see it from space, this huge, like, noxious cloud coming out of the Wuhan area. They've got some pretty serious furnaces, but from what I understand, these furnaces are popping up right next to the COVID quarantine camps, the shielding centers, like in Australia and America and elsewhere. So what I'm trying to get the point across to you when I show you the picture of Satan Claus here with the swastika is not just for fun and kicks and giggles. I'm saying, look out. We're watching this because it's not about history. It's about what they want for your fucking future. If we don't stop them.
Ovens of extremely modern design and heated by coke were made by a concern which customarily manufactures baking ovens. The firm's name is clearly inscribed. All bodies were finally reduced to bone ash.
How many bodies? How many bodies to make that pile of bone ash?
Civilians walked from the neighboring
city. Not just one day.
Begin a forced tour of the camp. There are many smiling faces, and according to observers, at first the Germans act as though this was something being staged for their benefit.
You see these people? These are the citizens.
One of the first things that the German civilians see as they reach the interior of the camp is the parchment display. On a table for all to gaze upon is a lampshade made of human skin, made at the request of an SS officer's wife. Large pieces of skin have been used for painting pictures.
How lovely. These are the citizens, you understand? These are the townspeople. You and me, just doing what we're told, right? Yeah, sure, they've got a camp over there for all the political prisoners, but we're just the German citizens, right? I mean, you know, burn up those prisoners, good God, you know it's them or us, isn't it? I didn't know you were making lampshades and painting canvases out of them, but go for it, I guess. Who's going to stop you? It's a death cult. These Nazis, the Nazis, not the Germans.
One-fifth their normal size.
The Nazis.
And other exhibits of Nazi origin are shown to the townspeople.
Nazis all over the planet, not just about Germany. Operation Paperclip is declassified. Said that most of the Nazis went to work for the United States government. In 11-22-63, they took over the presidency. There's been Nazis in the White House ever since, 11-22-63.
Where the stench, filth, and misery defied description. They see the result of lack of care in the bad case of trench foot.
Jesus. This shit's gonna fucking haunt me. It's gonna haunt me for life.
Other evidences of horror, brutality, and human indecency are shown, and these people are compelled to see what their own government had perpetrated.
compelled to see what their own government had perpetrated. Compelled to see what their own government had perpetrated. Think about what your own government may perpetrate. You're not there to be your fucking friend, folks.
Correspondents assigned to the Buchenwald story have given wide notice to the well-fed, well-dressed appearance of the German civilian population of the Weimar area.
Dachau.
Look at the size of that fucking facility.
Factory of Horrors.
Dachau, Factory of Horrors.
One of the oldest of the Nazi prison camps. It is known that from 1941 to 1944, up to 30,000 people were entombed here at one time. And 30,000 were present when the Allies reached Dachau. The Nazis said it was a prison for political dissenters, habitual criminals, and religious enthusiasts.
Political dissenters. Oh, wait, like an anti-vaxxer? Oh, political dissenter? Oh, you mean like some kind of racist Trump supporter, some insurrectionist? A domestic terrorist? Oh, he's a political dissenter. Oh, well, I guess, you know, we've got to do, seize their bank account. Yeah. Oh, those truckers, right? They're political dissenters. Ain't no protesting. Oh, you want to protest? This is what's happening in China right now. Political dissenters. Habitual criminals, you know what I'm talking about. And people with religious conviction that resisted the death cult of the Nazis. Anybody that wasn't a Satanist, I guess, would be your religious enemy. Religious enthusiasts. Fucking 60,000 they just enumerated right now. She's probably a lot more than that.
When these scenes were filmed, over 1,600 priests, representing many denominations, still remained alive. They came from Germany, Poland, Czechoslovakia, France, and Holland.
Okay, just remember that the clergy is always a target. The clergy is always a target. It's the same thing. It's the same thing with the Bolsheviks. It was the same thing with the great leap forward of the Cultural Revolution. Chairman Mao, and even today, right, Uyghurs and all that. They want to take out clergy and religious enthusiasts. Why? Because government is God. It doesn't like competition. It's satanic.
Trains arrive, carrying more dead than living. Those strong enough to try.
Okay, sorry, I just keep pausing it, but incoming prison trains. You know, they had the train tracks just rolling right up to the fucking gates of these camps. That's important because when you look at the shielding centers that the CDC was hiring at the shielding centers. I don't know if they built it. I guess it was built by FEMA or Department of Homeland Security or some shit, right? Use your tax money. But they got train tracks right there just like the fucking Nazis. Imagine that.
To Dachau from outlying points which were threatened by the Allied advance. This is how they look when they arrive.
You fucking get a good look at that. Honor these men and women. Honor these people. Understand, you are not insulated from this experience.
Some survived.
There's nothing protecting you from experiencing that. It's just around the fucking corner.
Others died after the liberation.
Think the UN's gonna protect you? The UN wants to fucking do it. They're gonna be doing it with robot dogs and fucking all kinds of other shit. It's not gonna be Billy from Alabama, the National Guard, when they bring in the police state people. You just look at Australia, look at Canada, look at what happened.
As in the case of
those weren't
camps,
Australian or Canadians.
People were brought in to view the dead.
The so-called police, they were fucking beating people.
This is what the liberators found in
running over them with horses. God damn it. These are my brothers and sisters. These are my fathers, my uncles and aunts. This is my children. This is my grandchildren. This is me. This is my friends. This is my family. Stacked like fucking cordwood. Starved. It's a pile of fucking bones with skin on them.
Hanging in orderly rows were the clothes of prisoners who had been suffocated in a lethal gas chamber. They had been persuaded.
Remember Carnegie? Dale Carnegie started the gas chamber.
Were provided.
They gave them towels and soap like they were going to go fucking take a shower. Here's your towels and soap. Take off your clothes. Hang them up.
The shower bath.
And everybody in the shower, you can turn on the fucking shower water. Oh shit, it's not shower water. You're not gonna need that soap or that fucking towel. You're dead.
The dummy shower head.
How cool. How cool. Great.
The engineer's room. The intake and outlet pipe. Push buttons.
It'd really suck if there's those pipes got fucking busted and the gas came into the engineer's room, huh? Cyanide powder was used to generate the lethal smoke. Cyanide powder, okay.
From the gas chamber, the bodies were removed to the crematory.
Crematory. They go from the gas chamber to the crematory. They gas you, and then they incinerate your corpse so they don't have to smell you. Dale Carnegie was the first to use gas chambers in America before the Nazis. Where do you think Hitler got the great idea and the money? Jesus. Honor these men. Look at this, you fucking goddamn, this starvation shit. These fucking bastards. It's not just the Nazis, the Bolsheviks, they did it, Stalin did it. Yeah. Yeah. Even worse when it's you. They still like to do it. There's a food shortage coming. Belsen Vossegasse.
I am the officer. The Sex Pistols. The Regiment of Royal Artillery.
There's a food shortage coming, right?
Our most urgent task.
It's already happening. You're cutting off the fuel and all that shit.
The dead. Up to present, we have buried about 17,000 people.
17,000.
To bury about half as much again. When we came here, conditions were indescribable. The people had had no food for 6 days and were eating turnips.
24,000 people.
The cookhouses have now been organized, and although they have to be guarded so that everybody gets a fair share of the food, things are now going fairly well. The officers and men regard this job as a duty that has to be performed, and none of us are likely to forget what the German people have done here.
It wasn't the German people who did it. It was the fucking Nazis. They would do it in any country. They do it in their... It doesn't matter.
Speech of the woman doctor at concentration camp, Bergen-Belsen.
It's not about the German people.
24th of April, 1945. This is the doctor in charge of the female
Nazis.
Section of the concentration camp, Bergen-Belsen. She was a prisoner at this camp.
Dass man hat uns Häftlinge in einem schmutzigen, verlausten Lager auf der Erde geschmissen, Tausende auf eine nur Erde ohne Decken.
Started in America.
There were no covers, straw stacks or beds.
Americans were the first to use gas chambers.
Had to lie directly on the ground.
But they didn't hang Dale Carnegie, did they?
Of a loaf of bread and some watery soup daily.
Wonder why not?
Almost 75% of the people were bloated from hunger. An epidemic of typhus broke out. 250 women and thousands of men died daily. In the men's camp, they cut out liver, heart, and other parts of the dead.
Oh, because he was a billionaire elite. He was one of them. He was a master race.
Und andere Teile des Körpers ausgeschnitten und aufgefressen. Man wollte uns keine Medikamente geben.
In the gas chambers for the greater good. There's too many people, you too much stuff.
Essen, das welches wurde vom Roten Kreuz für uns Häftlinge geschickt.
Und a bunch of useless eaters. Cannon fodder.
No medicines were available.
Kissinger problems.
The SS men had collected everything. 2 days before the British Army came, the first Red Cross food was distributed. 2 months before, 150 kilograms of chocolate had been sent to the children of the camp. 10 kilograms were distributed. The rest the commandant kept for himself and used it as barter to his personal advantage.
You mean does it all turn? So fucking Nazi move.
Mit uns hat man verschiedene Experimente gemacht. Die Sanitäter und Ärzte haben auf Häftlinge Spritzen gemacht. Zum Beispiel 20 cm, Kubikzentimeter Benzin intravenös gespritzt, so dass nach ein paar Minuten ist der Mensch gestorben. Auf solche Weise hat man auf uns experimentiert. Man hat Frauen genommen, junge, 19-jährige, schöne Frauen,
She adds that various medical experiments were made on the prisoners. Doctors gave some of them intravenous injections.
Okay. Do you think that's a little bit of an important little piece right there? That's why we have the Nuremberg Code. Okay, which says that nobody's ever going to have to take experimental injections again because of the horrors of the atrocities committed by the Nazis in the Nazi eugenics programs that Rockefeller developed and funded. It's in Wikipedia. Look it up. Rockefeller also gave a big chunk of Manhattan to the UN. So Rockefeller, the Rockefeller Foundation, good old philanthropic Rockefeller, and Bill Gates, right? The Geneva Vaccine Alliance. Bill Gates, who gives billions to the World Health Organization, run by the UN, which is, again, Rockefeller. Rockefeller Foundation developed and built, funded, and supported Auschwitz and these other facilities. You know, they needed some startup capital. Well, sure, once they had rounded up a bunch of Jewish people and stolen all of their possessions, it was the spoils of war, right? I mean, you see there's like crates of wedding rings. Just imagine, like, how many fingers it takes to fill up a crate of wedding rings. But they have crates of wedding rings, like pictures of German soldiers with them. Well, but you don't start out that way. I mean, you've got to have the startup capital. Sure, once, you know, once you've done that, then you can funnel it into your Swiss bank account. Because the Swiss, they're neutral. Just a bunch of good-hearted bankers in Switzerland, right? Sure, we'll take your gold. I don't care where it came from. Okay, cool. Do you mind if I mean, you know, I'm a Nazi and stuff. I had to bring in all this Jewish gold, right? That I'd stole, but do you mind if I just hang out here? You got a problem with me? No, 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 we're cool with Nazis in Switzerland. We're neutral. Neutral in Switzerland. Okay, what if I just start the UN here? Yeah, that's a good idea. Sure, it's good. Good location. Lots of banks. Lots of bankers. Oh, the international bankers, like the IMF, the International Monetary Fund. Oh, who do you think owns the Federal Reserve? Anybody in America know the answer to that question? Who owns that fucking bank? The Federal Reserve cartel, right? It wouldn't be Rockefeller, Rothschild, and J.P. Morgan Chase, would it? Oh, maybe it is. Maybe it is. Well, gosh, is there even a bank on the face of the planet that's not controlled by Rothschild? Yeah, there's like two. North Korea and Iran. So far away. You wonder why they're the bad boys on the block, huh? Yeah. Yeah. There were a few other countries on the list, too, like Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Lebanon. Remember Gaddafi? Yeah, yeah. Well, now they have a Rothschild bank in Libya. Yeah. At any rate, not that it matters, right? Not that we're going to just follow the money and, like, that's going to solve everything. But, again, Hitler's father was a Rothschild. His last name was Rothschild until his mother got married to Hitler. So Adolf Hitler's father, Aloysius, or I don't know what the fuck, how you say it's like A-L-O-I-S in Wikipedia, but I'm just going to say Aloysius because it's easier to say it. He was born Aloysius Rothschild. And he was that way for about 7 or 8 years, and then his mother got married. She was a servant at the House of Rothschild in Vienna and got pregnant. It's well known. And she had the baby, and it was Adolf Hitler's father. But when Adolf Hitler's father was born, his last name was Rothschild. He took the name Hitler when his mother got married. Are you following that? So all of his talk about the Jewish people and all of this stuff. Now we can get into the bloodlines. That's another story, because truth be told, even though the Rothschilds claim to be Ashkenazi Jews, they're not really. We all know they're Khazar, and Khazarians are not, like, actually, technically, really Jewish. So, you know, by bloodline, by their race. Maybe they're the master race. Do you think that's what it is? Could it be that the Khazars are the master race? They have kind of, even though they said that they were Jewish, they've always had it out for the Jewish people. They really have. Which is why people get confused and they're like, oh, the Jewish people are, they're running all the banks and they're evil. You know? But they're talking about, like, the Khazar Mafia, basically. So, all right. Thank you, brother. I gotta translate here what you wrote. I'm probably talking a lot instead of playing this video, but I stopped it here for a reason. I stopped it here because of the injections. The injections. The forced injections. They always want to do it. And it's important that we also understand the Rothschild, Rockefeller vaccine, Bill Gates connection here, UN, World Health Organization, it's all the same bucket of shit. The ones that are the reason why we needed the Nuremberg Code after this happened then started the United Nations to be the global police to make sure it never happens again. Wink, wink. Are you fucking kidding me? So Rockefeller builds these extermination camps, gives Hitler the money to do it, and then after the war, they hang a few of them at Nuremberg and come up with this code that says you never have to be injected again, wink, wink. And we're going to set up a world police, the United Nations. Rockefeller. The one who built the camps? Yeah, we'll make sure it's never going to happen again. Wink, wink. Are you fucking kidding me? That's what happened, people. That's what happened. Okay. I'm going to read what the translator says here, Roman, in chat. You typed, and I translated, and it says that questions about Ukraine now need to talk to China, not to give Russia weapons. And so that is a very important part of the equation, because China would very much like to invade Taiwan. And so maybe they would need Russia's, you know, support to do that. They don't necessarily need Russian troops, but they might get Russian support with weapons and such, right? And so maybe this is the primer for that. Like, okay, I'll scratch your back and you scratch my back. So China says, okay, Russia, you go first, and we'll scratch your back. But we're next, and we're gonna go do what you did in Ukraine, we're gonna do it in Taiwan. I'm gonna need you to scratch my back. Are we cool? And Russia's like, fuck yeah, because I don't have any other friends right now in the world. I got all of the West against me for no reason. I've got the IMF, you know, like, the IMF is the one who deposed whoever was the legitimate elected leader in 2014 in Ukraine. I don't remember his name. But it was the IMF through George Soros. People maybe know George Soros or don't, but follow the money. I mean, he's one of these billionaire dickheads. He's a literal Nazi, literally. Like, you have to understand, these people are literally, actually Nazis. Okay. I get worked up. But he's a billionaire, and he's like millions that go towards Black Lives Matter and this kind of stuff. I mean, he claims it all so he doesn't have to pay taxes, so you can see where it goes. I mean, it's not a secret. But he brags, right, about how he is building an empire. Like, he's no longer the Soviet Empire, it's the Soros Empire. Like, he wants to take over. And it's sick. It's just a sickness. So, but he has the IMF, right, backing him. Who does Putin have? So yeah, it comes down to China, you know, and China's going to do it. They're going to give him weapons because China wants weapons from Russia when they invade Taiwan. So it's all set up for that. So yeah, they're going to do it. They're going to give Russia needs weapons, right? Here's America's giving billions, just billions of dollars worth, right, of military weapons and vehicles and shit. And then here's like a video clip, right, of like 500 million, like half a billion, right, a half a billion dollars worth of American military, technical might that just arrived at a Ukraine base, right, or whatever. And so, yeah, we got the goods, boys. We're about to break it out. We're going to split it up. You get the good stuff after I do. And, I don't know, it was hypersonic or what, some shit just fucking out of nowhere. That shit was obliterated, just I hope nobody got hurt. But there just went a half a billion U.S. tax dollars on aid to Russia, or aid to Ukraine, rather. And I'm just saying, Putin's got to get support too somewhere, right? He's got all of the West basically against him, and it was a situation where they kind of they made this whole thing necessary. This whole conflict, this big war, it didn't need to happen. They wanted this to happen. This is they've been there's nothing they love more than war. So I figured out something else, and this is because of Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, which is a document. And in that document, they talk about, and I'll get back to the video here in a second, but I stopped it because of the injections. But then you chatted something about these weapons with China and Russia, and yeah, that's going to happen. That's going to happen because China wants the... they want their back scratched, so they're going to be scratching his back. And, they're both in the same boat. Like, the whole West will be against them either way, so all they have really is each other. And Iran's so far away. So Iran will be next. They'll join next, and that'll be... That's Gog and Magog. That is the... Armageddon battle. So what we see in these videos, I'm not saying it to be dramatic. I'm saying it so that we get psychologically prepared, get spiritually and psychologically prepared, get fucking ready, because this is some horror show shit. This is horror show shit. And what's going on right now in that conflict in Ukraine and Russia, with the soldiers just on the level of person to person, they're not following the rules of engagement. There's war crimes happening. There's shit like they're shooting off the crotches. You know what I mean? Just like the Nazis in this fucking video, which I hadn't seen before, but they pulled the guys, they pulled him apart, they pulled his fucking crotch apart. Why do you have to do that? What part of being at war says you've got to pull a man's crotch apart? You're a sick fucking bastard. Anyway, I stopped the video because of the injections, but it's very important that you recognize the connection between Rockefeller vaccines, right? If you knew about Rockefeller, Standard Oil, I'm talking John D. Rockefeller, Standard Oil, and petrochemical pharmaceuticals. He gave rise... You got John D. Rockefeller gave rise to big oil and big pharma. Big pharma. Big pharma. And the idea that they would use vaccines for population control as a bio attack weapon. Oh, that's some Alex Jones territory there, Mr. Rockstone. You know why? Do you know why? Because Alex Jones reads their documents. It's in their documents, man. So I have a pretty extensive library. There's a thing in the about, right? If you on my Twitch channel here, if you click over to the about tab, and I've got all the different panels, there's a top secret RSTV library link there, and I've been adding to it. I add to it like every day. just these fucking documents. So I'm going to play the video again. I'm going to start playing the video again, but I only stopped it so that we could talk about Rockefeller injections, experimental injections, forced injections of experimental fucking shit. Rockefeller, Nazis, forced injections. Your future is now, if you allow it.
Centimeters of benzene, which caused the victims to die. She concludes by saying that sterilizations and other gynecological
sterilizations, gynecological experiments. Oh, they were only the 19-year-old girls. They didn't do gynecological experiments on anyone else, just the 19-year-old girls. Oh, that's interesting.
Kramer, Camp Commandant.
Is that in the IBM computer records?
Such was the speed of the Allied advance that the guards were taken before they had time to flee. Inside Belton, the same story. Starvation and sickness. Evidence of beatings and outright murder was on every hand.
The beatings, the brutality. The brutality, man. This is gonna haunt me forever. We need to honor these people.
Nameless victims were numbered for records which the Germans
nameless
destroyed.
Victims were numbered for records. Oh jeez. Okay, I was trying to pause it, but I don't want to pause it on that. It's just, it's horrifying. I honor this fucking holy shit. Jesus. We have to honor these people, man. It's a real horror show, but I paused it just again because I wanted to draw attention to the fact that they were keeping these numbered records, that there were no names. And apparently I have to go back to this part where the guys sprawled out, but there were no names, but they were keeping the numbers in the records. What were they using to keep those numbers in the records? Remember, or do you know, it's the IBM computers. IBM, Microsoft, Bill Gates, Rockefeller. Okay, nameless victims were numbered for records. Numbered for records, which the Germans were keeping in the IBM machines. That's where they were entering their numbers, the records. The Germans destroyed. They destroyed the IBMs. They didn't want you to have the IBMs. Not they even cared about really the records. They didn't want you to have the IBM computer technology. Right? Not till they went to work for you, right? Once the Nazis went to work for the United States government, well, then we had NASA and all sorts of technology. It's curious. IBM. I didn't finish a point I was trying to make earlier, which is one thing that I've learned about these the way this apparently fucking works. Ever, at least since Waterloo, I mean, probably before that, but at least since Napoleon at Waterloo, is what the Rothschilds do, or what they have done, or Rothschilds banks, their modus operandi. And this is in Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, where it actually references another book called The Synagogue of Satan, if you want to know more about this Rothschild character. But what they did as a matter of practice is, Rothschild would withhold money, make money scarce on purpose. Make it scarce on purpose. Jesus, I'm going to have fucking nightmares tonight. Oh, God. We have to honor these people. Honor these fucking people. Honor them. You know, look away. It is a horror show. It is a fucking horror show, and it's going to be our future. This isn't just in history books. This is what they fucking want for us if you read their documents. Rothschild would make money scarce. Sanitary conditions were so appalling that heavy equipment had to be brought in to speed the work of cleaning. Oh, God, Jesus, oh, fucking Christ. This is what I saw a picture of earlier. Just this. Honor these people. You honor them because they didn't have respect. They didn't have a respectful death. Look at this. There's no respect there. I mean, you can't, I guess. I don't know what the fuck. Holy shit. I don't have any room in my world where that's okay. The speed of the work and all of this, we got to bring in bulldozers? Not if I'm making that decision. I'm sorry, it's going to take a few more days to have respect for these people? Holy shit. Jeez, this right here is a fucking horror.
This was Bergen-Belsen.
This is why we need to honor them. Give them some honor. They were robbed. Sorry, I have to translate what you wrote here, buddy. Thank you for chatting. Thank you. I'm really glad you're here. Well, that's the end of the shit show, folks. Here, let me, I'm sorry, I'm doing stuff with the chat, so I wasn't so quick on the technical directing. Here, I've got a scene that doesn't have a swastika in it, thank you. All right, so that was that video. Now, again, like I said, part of the reason that I wanted to play that is because of what we're looking at. Okay. And I'm not sure, so I'm going to read what the translator said here, but and I'm not sure if it translated, like, what you're saying. It says, spin to spin is woe. And I know we were looking at bulldozers pushing piles of people into a ditch. So, and you got some emojis with tears. I mean, we, you know, this is as grave as it gets. So, spin to spin is woe. I don't know that the translator got that correct. But there is woe. Woe is, it's this word, is it whore? Is it this word?
Whore.
Whore. Calamity, grief, woe.
Whore.
Woe. Yeah. So, I've been publishing things on RSTV, so the website RSTV. I got a thing in my throat. And I'm going to have to wrap this up. It's, God, it's been so much fun. It just went so fast. But, I want to also share with you an article that I wrote on rstv.mikerockstone.com. And, and I'll put the link also here in chat. It's not as, like actually what we're talking about as this other piece that I'm working on. So I'm working on another piece that, that is about the secret Nazi agenda to take over the world. Excuse me. Yep. There we go. Now we're feeling better. But this piece here is, it's called, I just wrote this, last night, Followed the Science, Now Apologize. And this is because there was the Pfizer documents that were finally released unredacted. There's about 11,000 pages. And it says essentially like that they knew, they had all the data. They knew that these things are fucking deadly killer fucking poison. They knew that it was poison. The FDA knew it was poison. CDC knew it was poison. They all knew it was poison. And they said, get vaccinated. Why? For years, you shamed those who tried to warn you. You said, follow the science. But you followed scientism. You said, don't ask questions. Do what they tell you. Stop researching. Believe the fact checkers. Censorship saves lives. And you turned your back on the people who rejected their poison. Now, after all that has come to light, do you still believe the corrupted lies masquerading as truth? The first wave, 2020, when we first began getting news about the novel coronavirus called SARS-CoV-2 and the COVID-19 sickness, it was scary and we were all concerned. You know what? I think I might just have the robot read this because the robot, I was trying him out, you know, and robot seems to do pretty good on this, so down at the end of New Normal, and we'll let it go till about there. Let's see here. I might have to cut my microphone. I don't know. We'll see how it goes.
The first wave 2020 when we first began getting news about the novel coronavirus called SARS-CoV-2 and the COVID-19 sickness. It was scary and we were all concerned. We'd been taken by surprise and, because we didn't have any information aside from that provided by the legacy mockingbird so-called mainstream media, we trusted the authorities when they said the world needed to be quarantined. Locked down. Isolated.
Yeah.
We trusted them when they said that they just needed 2 weeks to flatten the curve, and so we obeyed. Then, once we'd been secured in our chambers, scared and confused, they polluted our minds with hype stories of fear porn and death. Suddenly, there were millions of cases around the planet, and all of our octogenarian family members began dying at once. They said it came from a sick bat sold in a wet market in Wuhan, China, and they showed us video clips of Chinese citizens dropping dead in the streets.
Right.
We were allowed to go shopping, but only the big corporate stores were allowed to stay open. While we'd been locked down in our chambers getting steeped in fear and confusion, they'd painted little squares and X's in straight lines on the store floors and sidewalks. We were told that we couldn't stand closer than 6 feet in front, 6 feet in back, and 6 feet on either side of another human being in public.
All at once,
public trash cans disappeared, public bathrooms were off limits, and there were signs at every entrance which read, mask required. Some businesses even began to refuse cash, out of fear of spreading COVID-19. What really happened up until then, it was understood that you never quarantine a healthy person. It was understood that when you quarantine someone it's because they may be carrying an infectious disease for which a period of observation would be necessary. But they told us that we could all be asymptomatic carriers and spreaders of the disease and that it was possible for us to remain that way for up to 14 days.
Right.
So, not a single person on the planet could call themselves healthy anymore because we were all asymptomatic.
Asymptomatic.
For 2 weeks we agreed that all of us could be unknowingly sick with a highly infectious and deadly disease that had no symptoms while they flattened the curve for our safety. So we all voluntarily participated in this unprecedented global lockdown initiative proposed by the world's health authorities, even though up until then, it was understood that lockdowns are something that happens in prison to control the inmate population. We've since learned that at least 100,000 octogenarians were murdered in their beds in America and Britain with COVID protocol and then labeled as deaths from COVID. State and government-operated so-called health agencies had begun stocking up on the lethal injection pharmaceutical midazolam and the equally lethal remdesivir, which were administered under COVID protocol, a year before we'd ever heard of COVID-19. It has since been established beyond a shadow of a doubt that the SARS-CoV-2 novel coronavirus, which did indeed originate from Wuhan, China, did not come from an infected bat carrying an organically mutated virus that was sold at a wet market. Gene sequencing analysis now confirms that the COVID-19 spike protein contains a DNA sequence patented by Moderna 3 years before the pandemic. So, it's a 1 in 3 trillion chance that the SARS-CoV-2 virus did not originate from a lab, isn't at least partly owned by Moderna, and wasn't intentionally released to initiate a plandemic. But, that's not the story they told us. So, many of us just trusted the science and did whatever was asked of us in the name of safety even when it made no sense. It made no sense that we could continue to shop at the large, corporate chain stores while all the mom and pop businesses were forced to close their doors to the public. It made no sense that we couldn't spread the virus as long as we stood 6 feet apart from each other when an airborne virus could easily travel 6.5 feet. It made no sense that wearing a surgical mask, a handkerchief, or an N95 could prevent an airborne virus from spreading in any way since air must be able to flow in and out of any face covering or we'd all suffocate. Yet, we allowed our logic to be murdered in the name of safety and anyone who drew attention to these absurdities was humiliated and shunned. The vaccine solution our governments around the world marched in lockstep with the authorities of the World Health Organization and began imposing unprecedented emergency mandates based on the rising number of cases of COVID-19. In the blink of an eye, career bureaucrats at the FDA, the CDC, and the WHO were given supreme authority over our elected officials and our lives. Test, 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 became the mantra coming from behind every podium and repeated by the talking head tools of mind control on the idiot box. More tests, more cases, more COVID deaths. 2 weeks to flatten the curve stretched into a month, then more, and they told us we'd have to stay in lockdown until the pharmaceutical companies could develop a vaccine. Up until then, it would have taken years to develop a vaccine that could be proven to be safe and effective before it could be approved for public use. But, they pulled out all of the stops for COVID-19 and got it done in just a matter of months. With the president's approval, they enacted Operation Warp Speed, and in no time at all the FDA was ready to issue emergency use authorization to Moderna, Pfizer, and Johnson & Johnson for their unconventional, untested, experimental mutagenic mRNA vaccine serum formulas. Millions of people gladly rolled up their sleeves believing these injections would bring an end to lockdowns and return our everyday lives to the banal normal we used to know. We all know how that turned out. What really happened with the corrupt World Health Organization acting as conductor? A chorus broke out around the world and nearly every head of state in every country could be heard singing in apparent unison about this unprecedented opportunity for a great reset. Great reset. The world was allowed to go back to work but only under certain conditions and we soon discovered our old banal normal had been replaced with a new normal. Everyone was told they needed to take a PCR test, whether they felt sick or not. Everyone was mandated to take an experimental vaccine injection, or else don't leave the house. Those who resisted taking an experimental mutagenic vaccine serum were labeled as anti-vaxxers and were shunned and humiliated for not following the science and for selfishly spreading COVID to the vaccinated. Up until then, it was understood that a vaccine would, by definition, confer immunity to the particular disease for which it was designed, meaning it would be impossible for an unvaccinated person to infect a vaccinated person. So, they changed the definition of vaccine. The PCR test that we were all urged to take was known to be scientifically meaningless as a diagnostic tool, especially pertaining to COVID-19 since they had never isolated the SARS-CoV-2 virus in vitro to establish the necessary gold standard which would calibrate the test. It was, however, scientifically predictable that the PCR test would more likely than not produce false positive results which could be used to fuel the number of COVID cases and deaths with, not from COVID. the rising number of cases due to false positives plus more testing, and the rising number of deaths with COVID not from COVID could then be used to justify mandated injections for everyone in any age group, even newborns.
With COVID.
Footnote here, COVID. Both the CDC and the FDA have since admitted that the results from PCR testing are unreliable and have removed the emergency use authorization approval. Furthermore, the CDC announced recently that they were using the nightmare nasal swabs used in PCR testing to collect your DNA and include it in their databanks. Did you give them permission to do that, or did they steal it from you? The normal in the wake of these abuses and violations of our human rights by the WHO, which is to say the UN, and by our own governments and elected officials, many people have begun to awaken to the fact that there is something rotten in Denmark. If that's you, welcome to the party. Hey. On the other hand, there are a great many who are incredibly still convinced they are standing on moral high ground and looking down their noses while they wag a shameful finger at the rest of us. If that's you, maybe it's time for you to follow the science, which is a method of asking questions and seeking answers, instead of placing your blind faith in scientism. You may be lost forever to the dream spell of the New World Order and go to your grave believing that everything you learned on CNN was the truth, that fact checkers are a source of facts, and that anti-vaxxers are responsible for your adverse reactions to the mutagenic serum that you keep injecting. So be it. It's not my job to tell you what to think, and it's probably futile to try and deprogram you anyway. But your willful ignorance, your hubris, and your false morality are a greater danger to the future of humanity than is the genetically engineered bioweapon of the SARS-CoV-2 novel coronavirus. As a result of billions of people being injected with these mutagenic serums, the new normal is heart attacks for kids, professional athletes collapsing mid-game, increased cancer, and the return of AIDS, or VAIDS. The pharmaceutical companies, you know, the ones who hold the patent to DNA sequences found in the virus, have made billions and billions in government contracts for your free vaccine. While mortality from all causes was actually less in 2020, the year of the pandemic, compared to 2019, insurance companies have reported an increase of over 40% for deaths from all causes in 2021, the year of your miracle vaccine. Still feeling pretty good about demanding everybody to be injected with the poison. Still don't believe the vaccine is a weaponized, deadly poison. Still following the science as it is spoon-fed to you by the Operation Mockingbird media on CNN. Still morally superior and wagging your finger at the pure blood vanguards of the human race. Of course you are. But, if you had any integrity, you would admit that you were wrong. You would show some self-awareness and humility, rather than repulsive pride, and you would apologize to the people who have stood their ground and tried to warn you, even when you turned your back on them.
Even when you turned your back on them, Turkey. This, I read this, or, you know, I mean, I finished it last night, I published it last night, but the whole point here is that I've had friends and family just totally turn their back on me because of my feelings, my position, my thoughts and beliefs about the vaccine and wearing a mask and all that stuff. And it's like, you're not one of us, then you don't exist, you know. In fact, we can't do business. I don't do business with your kind, people who believe what you believe. You're discriminating against me because of my religious beliefs? No, it's not because of your religion. It's because of the vax. Right. It's my religious belief. It's science. You gotta follow the science. You see, I don't know, folks. I really don't. And if you really think you're still like in the clear and on the high moral ground, like you got the jabs and you're like, yeah, it was good, they needed, we all need to get it. Well, you didn't get it? Oh, geez, what's a, you know, man, you're one of those? Oh, man, you know, wag my finger, you're shameful. God, you're, what are you, an idiot, or you're racist? Or you probably support Trump, even though Trump's walking around like, yeah, take the vaccine, I took it, it's good. Fuck him. Fuck you, orange man. All these fucking dickbags, they don't rule me. I rule me. I decide what I'm gonna fucking inject in my body. That was why we just watched what we watched. The Nuremberg stuff, all the laws, the codes, the international shit, right? And then we had to have an international police to enforce that code. Who's it gonna be? Oh, how about the same guys that fucking are the reason that we need the code? Let's just put the Nazis in charge as the global police of the... What? Oh, no wonder the Nuremberg Code's not being enforced. You put the Nazis in charge? Are you fucking kidding me? No, we're not kidding you. What are you? So you're a conspiracy theorist? You have a problem with that? You have a problem with the Nazis running it? Yeah. The UN, it's all the Nazis wanted, was the world on a silver fucking platter. They want the Reich to run Europe, like the EU. If the Reich is controlling the EU, then Hitler's dream has been accomplished. That's what he wanted, the pan-German state. And then tomorrow the world, Pinky, right? Like, Pinky in the Brain. You take over the world. So you got the EU, you got the UN, you got the World Health Organization, all of the great, all of those great philanthropic organizations, you know, UNICEF and all that shit. It's all run by Nazis. Well, then it can't be so bad, huh? Yeah, except for they're not doing what they say they're doing. They're all fucking fronts. So you get the Clintons in Haiti and all that shit. Like, that's what... This is all signaling, like, oh, we're the good people. Yes, we take the orphans. Yeah, what do you do with them? We eat them. We rape them, yeah? Why? What do you do with orphans? I mean, it's these people. All right, so... I'm just saying, man, like, if you've got the jab, I get it, like, you thought, like, it was the right thing to do, they were so fucking, like, for you, I couldn't go to work if I didn't get it, right? Like, I mean, I don't have that problem, because I, you know, they do rock stone shit, but I get it, like, I totally fucking get it, that's the whole point, it's like, we were all coerced, and we were lied to, but can you admit that you were lied to and coerced? Can you look around and see people dying? So when I wrote this piece, I include, so this piece right here, the Follow the Science part, I didn't write this, I wrote Follow the Science, I didn't write the article underneath it. But everything in this article that I wrote, it's got links to the sources, like this business about, I mean, you can come over here and click it yourself, but I'm just saying, I'm not just saying garbage, folks. I can't say it unless I can back it up, quite frankly, right? I mean... Otherwise, there's no power in it. There's no power if it's just my opinion. It's not my opinion. I'm trying to tell a story, and then here's the stuff I can back it up with. Oh, well, I checked the fact checkers, and they said you're a fucking liar. You're an idiot, probably. You don't even know what the fuck is going on. So, LOL. Yeah, I'm an idiot. I got it. Uh-huh. You went to the fact checkers, did you? You let Mickey Mouse and fucking... Zuckerberg tell you what to think? Is that it? And so they think I'm an idiot because I'm onto them? Fuck you. All right, so anyway, I love you, humanity. I really do. The reason I put this article up here, this is just, and here's the tweet. Like, I'm not going to get into this whole article, but this is the tweet. It's about the FOIA, right? The Freedom of Information Act request. There's apparently 11,000 plus pages that were released, and they were released before, but now they're unredacted. They were released before and they were redacted, which is actually great because now we got the unredacted, so we know what kind of shit they were redacting, which is very telling in itself. So basically, they were redacting shit like it shows here, you know, which you've got. So this, I believe, this link here takes you to the actual document, from Pfizer that was just released because of the Freedom of Information Act. So you can get this. It's the aftermarket experience, which has to do with their, their tests or something. But what the document shows basically is that all the stuff that's happening now, they knew it was going to happen, and it's fucking nefarious. So this is something from the Daily Exposé, which I guess since it's a pull quote, I'm going to read it real quick. An investigation of official government data has uncovered that
Fully vaccinated individuals are up to 3 times more likely to be infected with COVID-19, 2 times more likely to be hospitalized with COVID-19, and 3 times more likely to die of COVID-19 than unvaccinated individuals, pureblood vanguards of the human race. The question is why? Why? Sorry, I'm looking over here because that's where my screen is. One possibility is that, as feared, the vaccinated are suffering vaccine-associated enhanced disease, leading to conditions such as antibody-dependent enhancement and cytokine storm. In effect, this means the COVID-19 injections cause a vaccinated person's immune system to go into overdrive when they come into contact with the virus, causing harm to the person and worsening disease. But it turns out this possibility could actually be reality, because the latest round of confidential Pfizer documents published 1st of April 2022 confirms that both Pfizer and the FDA knew vaccine-associated enhanced disease was a possible consequence of the mRNA COVID-19 injections, and they received evidence of it occurring, including several deaths, but swept it under the carpet and claimed no new safety issues have been raised. Death isn't a safety issue, I'm sorry. Anyway. And then there's this link here, is Pfizer sought to conceal its internal documents for 75 years. Yeah, that's real. That happened a little while ago. Yep, they were trying to keep this from coming out for 75 years. Why so long, Pfizer? You expect us all to be fucking dead by then? From your injections? Why doesn't the CEO of Pfizer get an injection? Don't we all need to get one? Get vaccinated. It's a mandate. Oh, you can't go to work. The CEO of Pfizer can go to work without getting a vaccine? Why doesn't the CEO of Pfizer take it? What about the CEO of Moderna? And if you caught that in the article, but the DNA sequence that is that Moderna has a patent on, 3 years before COVID-19 pandemic, 3 years before the pandemic, Moderna acquired a patent on a genetic sequence that is found in the SARS-CoV-2 novel coronavirus. And that means there is a 1 in 3 trillion chance. There is a 1 in 3 trillion chance that the virus was not made in a lab that is not partly owned by Moderna, makers of the vaccine, right? I mean, of course he's got the patent on the virus. Why doesn't he take the vaccine? Oh, he's not for him. It's for you. It was for your health, right? No, it's a kill shot. It's fucking poison. What? They wouldn't want to do that. Why would my government want to kill me? So we just watched an hour of a government killing people. Hello? That government that was killing people like that, stacking them up like fucking cordwood so the Americans came in with bulldozers and thought that was okay? Those were funded and developed by Rockefeller. Rockefeller, who also funded and developed the UN. Do you understand? The same fucking people are running this business with the pharmaceuticals. You got a hard time kind of coming up to the conclusion that there's a depopulation agenda? Please visit the library at RSTV, the RSTV library. There is a link to it in the on my about. There's a panel. I'm gonna go ahead and click on it and then just copy and put the link in here. Why? What's the point? What is the point? Well, because you can either believe with the Mockingbird, Operation Mockingbird, okay? Which says the CIA admits, like, yes, we infiltrated the media. Yes, we used the TV for mind control. So what? It's all for the greater good. Government is God.
What? Yep. Okay. So Anderson Cooper on CNN, you know, that Vanderbilt, he wasn't in the CIA. I mean, he was never in the CIA. Sure, he might have been like an intern or something in college, wink, wink. Oh, so you were in the CIA? No. You think somebody in the CIA is going to tell you, yeah, I'm in the CIA. Or are they going to say, no, you're crazy. You're crazy. That's what a narcissist says. Okay. So old Georgie here with the wooden teeth said, if freedom of speech is taken away, then dumb and silent, we may be led like sheep to the slaughter. How poetic. How poetic. I have a feeling that that was one of the steps on the slippery slope for the folks that ended up in those extermination camps. I think at some point they weren't allowed to say what was on their mind, don't you? How far back in the process do you think? How many steps was it when they were first censored to when they were starved to death? How many steps? Because we're not allowed to say what's on our mind anymore, right? Censorship saves lives. Yeah, it's for the greater good. Wink, wink. Yeah, you're greater good. So these are my websites on the sidebar here. These are other websites that I have, that I do, that I make, that I do. But the library is important. I went ahead and I broke it into different categories to make it a little bit easier to navigate because it was kind of a mess. So now there's pretty much just four categories. There's the pandemic, there's Illuminati, depopulation, and mind control. But you see, now you can do this. See, I couldn't do it before, and I'd be like, oh, look, I'm such an amazing webmaster. Because I'm like, okay, well, I just want to be able to click that and go straight to the mind control section. Wow, how cool. So silent weapons for quiet wars, folks. That's the next step. And I've got a piece I'm working on for my Substack. I should have a link for my Substack. I totally need subscribers over there because I just started. So it would be super, super califragilisticexpialidociously cool if you would join me over there. I'm going to go ahead and type it in here and see if I get lucky. And then that we can put in. But I'm working on an article on my Substack that is about silent weapons for quiet wars. So here's that, followed the Science Now Apologize article that we were looking at. I totally need subscribers over here. It'd be super cool. I'm just saying it'd be super cool. Okay? So I'm working on and I might start just do it like a podcast because they have a whole thing where they do podcasts over here. And I already have like two podcasts on Spotify and Apple and stuff, but it's not me talking. It's like, you know how we just had the robot read it? It's a little bit more enhanced than that. But that's the basic idea. So this would be different for me. But why are you here, buddy? Oh, because I've got a draft I was working on. Got a draft. So you know what? I'm gonna show you what nobody shows you, man. I'm gonna show you the back end of stuff. Here we are, this is what it looks like a Substack. Wow, I'm like so not dark like I'm late. It's weird. Okay. It's freaky. Okay. Alright, man. Over here to the draft. I'm only here for one reason. Okay, I want to bring up the draft. Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, and that's what's over here in the mind control section of the library, is this document called Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars. I realized I have to do this in two parts, because this first part that I'm drafting on Substack is really a sort of background, a foundation of understanding where this document kind of comes from, and you know, this way we can get into what it's saying. Like in part two, we can start pulling apart Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, but I felt like I had to kind of like give some backstory, some basic stuff here that we don't really, you know, it's not in our textbooks. So the subtitle here is The Secret Nazi Agenda for World Domination. The Secret Nazi Agenda for World Domination. It's not a secret that Nazis want to dominate the world, but now we have the agenda.
New Order cool story. We were told that we'd never see the atrocities of Nazi eugenics, and then again, you can't see it so much in this format because it's a draft versus like published, and also the links are white and they're not colored, but there's a bunch of links in here. As I'm talking about stuff, I'm linking over to my sources, so I want that to be clear. That's very important to me. So let me start again. All right, we were told that we'd never see the atrocities of Nazi eugenics and the resulting genocidal Holocaust for the sake of a master race on this earth again. They made a big show of the Nazi trials for war crimes in Nuremberg, where a handful of judges and SS officers were hung until dead for such things as conspiracy and crimes against humanity. Our history books tell us about how the noble heads of state around the world gathered in accordance with one another and penned a new international code of conduct that would protect humanity from ever again being subjected to medical experimentation without informed consent. On our behalf, a new international police agency was established to enforce this and other codes of conduct for which the governing bodies of the world would be held accountable. This global peacekeeping force would have the power to prosecute any perceived violations of human rights. Without regard for the sovereignty of borders or of any nation state, they would keep us safe from systemic injustices meted out by unchecked tyrannical governments. They would fight to end world hunger. They would build schools in lesser developed countries. They would watch over the world's health and provide the gold standard in medical guidelines. What could go wrong? Spoiler alert, everything. The Nazi struggle. So if you don't know that the UN is founded by Nazis and run by Nazis, and it was the Nazis getting the world on a silver fucking platter at the end of the war, if you don't know that, then you probably don't know what I'm talking about there, about how they're going to fight world hunger and be the world police and shit. Like, you're not getting the irony of it, but I'm just letting you know. Spoiler alert. The Nazi struggle. And so this gets into a little bit of Hitler's background and kind of like what he was after and stuff. I'm gonna go ahead and read it up. I've only got a couple more sections where I have it completed, then I've got a bunch of stuff drafted that I want to add. So the Nazi struggle. To understand how absolutely nefarious the roots of the United Nations are, we'd have to take a closer look at the well-known leader of the National Socialist Party in Germany during World War II. That is to say, the man that we know as Hitler. History shows how this psychopath determinedly rose to power by means of brutish force and goon squads, dividing the people between Übermensch and Untermensch, subhumans, and, like, ruler humans, right? The Superman. Yeah, super duper man. This is Nazi land so good. We would leave it if we could. Okay. We bring the world new order. So that comes up also here. But, okay, Übermensch and Untermensch. To achieve his racial hygiene agenda and creation of the new order, pan-German racial state for the greater good of Germany. Such was his struggle, so to speak. Das Führer. It was bad. Can't do it. I'm not Spike Jones. Okay. Right into Führer's face. The Führer gave expression to his unshakable conviction. This is really what's happening right now. Think about it. Think about if the Reich controls Europe. The Führer gave expression to his unshakable conviction that the Reich will be the master of all Europe. We shall yet have to engage in many fights, but these will undoubtedly lead to most wonderful victories. From there on, the way to world domination is practically certain. Whoever dominates Europe will thereby assume the leadership of the world. little friend of ours that we like to call Joseph or whatever, Goebbels, Reich Minister of Propaganda. Detailed forever for posterity in Mein Kampf, 1926, Hitler laments the failed coup that landed him in prison and solicits the sympathies of whatever other demented master race, world domination, elite death cultists that he may. As luck would have it, by 1933, he had found the financial support that he needed from the Rockefeller Foundation, which had helped him develop and fund various Nazi eugenics programs that included the one that Joseph Mengele had worked in before moving on to Auschwitz. Considering the influence that American eugenics had upon the ideologies of Hitler, gaining the support of like-minded industrialists in the United States, such as Rockefeller, Carnegie, Kellogg, the dickbag with the cornflakes, Battle Creek, Michigan, for a better race, Goethe, Margaret Fuck You Sanger, and others, legitimized his fantasies of genocide and guaranteed his rise to power. You get that? Rockefeller, Carnegie, these sons of bitches legitimized Hitler's fantasies of genocide and then funded and helped him get there, developed, like, gave him the startup capital and got him going, guaranteeing his rise to power. Why would Rockefeller and Carnegie and Goethe and Sanger, why would they support Hitler? Well, because of the good genes. Good genes. He did have Rothschild. He was a Rothschild. He had no Hitler blood in him. Understand that, right? His father was born a Rothschild, whose mother married a man named Hitler. And so his father took on the name Hitler, which was his stepfather. So when Adolf was born, he was born with the last name Hitler, but his father's last name when he was born was Rothschild. Hitler was an illegitimate, you know, the handmaid or whatever in the House of Vienna there, the Rothschild, who got pregnant, oops. So illegitimate, but he was his father was a Rothschild. He was a Rothschild. So just keep that in mind. Good genes. He had good genes. See, there's certain blue bloods that are just born to rule over humanity, and you're not it. Certainly the Rothschilds are, because clearly they're ruling over humanity. They run all the banks around the world, so pretty much running your fucking life. Good genes. He must have good genes. We're not talking about Levi's, folks. The American eugenics movement was rooted in the biological determinist, like that, biological determinist, ideas of Charles Darwin's cousin, Sir Francis Galton. Do you know that? Do you know about Charles Darwin's cousin, Sir Francis Galton? He said, well, you're born. It's biological determinism. You're born. You're just born better than others. Certainly, if you're born with light skin, you're better than people that are born with dark skin. This is what they taught. This is the master race bullshit. It starts with Charles Darwin's cousin, as far as we can trace it back here in America, at least. The American eugenics movement was rooted in the biological determinist ideas of Charles Darwin's cousin, Sir Francis Galton, beginning around the 1880s. And he believed that differences in a person's ability were acquired primarily through genetics, and that eugenics, or genetic manipulation, selective breeding, like you would do for a fucking racehorse or something, could be implemented through selective breeding in order for the human race to improve in its overall quality, genetically speaking. Can we improve just give them a bunch of mRNA shots, improve their genetic
Oh my God. Okay, eugenics. All right. So, to improve in its overall quality, therefore allowing for humans to direct their own evolution. Only when they're saying humans direct their own evolution, they're saying that we, the master race, direct the evolution of the cattle. Everyone else. Right now, there's too many people using too much stuff, according to Ted Turner. I'm sorry, Ted, I'm not getting my private jet flown in on a private jet so I can sit around with a bunch of other dickbags who just do the same thing and talk about how everybody else is using too much stuff. And we gotta lock them down and stuff. We gotta kill them. We gotta sterilize them, keep them from having babies, whatever it takes. Let's eat the babies. Let's make them eat their babies. Cinemix? Okay. Yeah, it's a flavor enhancement. Just business as usual. Okay. So that's what he was saying. So Sir Francis Galton was saying that basically you're born, right? You're born. And that they can, the ones who are born to rule over everyone else, they can selectively breed you. So no, we're not going to have miscegeny, not misogyny, miscegeny, which is miscellaneous egeny, you know what I'm saying? Like, oh, we're not going to have the miscellaneous people mixing. They literally made laws against it. Because they're better than you. The word eugenics was first used by Sir Francis Galton in 1883 to describe the biological improvement of genes in human races. Really? The biological improvement of genes in human races, huh? And the concept of being well-born, which is to say being born of a noble family, which I call being born a blue blood, like, right? That's what the blue bloods are. They walk around their fucking crowns, right, throughout history. There's us and then there's them. Two classes. I think I get into that here. Of course, noble, in quotes, noble, families have made the argument since time immemorial that they are the descendants of a master race. They're the ones that say they're from a master race. The blue bloods, a race that they were born to rule over you. You weren't born of royal blood, were you? You're not born of the royal family. You're not in line for the throne. All right. Well, that's what I just got into. It's such a class aside. I gotta call it a night, basically. I'm gonna call it a night. So, just for a good time, we're gonna let Spike Jones take us out here.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Fuhrer's face. And is it red? Because this tuna sweeping the country and everybody's out jeering at him. Okay.
When the Fuhrer says, here's the battle race, be higher! Higher! Right in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer. He's a great disgrace, so be higher! Higher! Right in the Fuhrer's face.
Beautiful!
When her Goebbels says, be all the world in space, be higher! Higher! Right in her Goebbels' face, when her Goering says, they'll never bomb this place, be higher! Higher! Right in her Goering's face. Are we not the Superman? Hey, pure Superman!
Yeah, we are the Superman! Super duper Superman! Is this not the land so good?
Would you leave it if you could?
Yeah, this not the land is good. We would leave it if we could.
We bring the world to order. Heil Hitler's world to order. Every one of four race will love the Fuhrer's face when we bring to the world disorder. When the Fuhrer says, be a master race. Be higher! Higher! In the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer. He's a great disgrace, so be higher! Higher! In the Fuhrer's face, when the Fuhrer says, be the master ace, be higher! Higher! In the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer. He's a great disgrace, so be higher! Higher! Right in the Fuhrer's face! Hey, thank you, everybody. You know, this shit right here. I'm pretty tolerant. I'll tell you what, I'm pretty tolerant just about everything. But this shit right here,
Nope, never, not okay. This shit right here is real, and that's why we gotta bring attention to it. These cockroaches, man. All right. I love you, humanity. Rock the fuck on.